table with this. We have two big stories, okay? We all know that there are kids on the border that are being taken from their families. We all know that that is not right. The question is, why is it still going on? Now, Mr. Cortes, do you disagree with that assertion that it is wrong for kids to be taken from their families?
It's wrong, but where does the fault lie? Does it lie with the families or with the United States? You know, if you break into my house in the middle of the night, you're not an undocumented person, you're a thief. If you break into our country, if you show up without permission at our border and break the law and try to smuggle your children to the United States, you are going to be separated from your children. That's a shame for those children. Absolutely. It's heartbreaking. But it's not our fault as a country. It's the parents' fault for allowing that to happen, for forcing that to happen.
So, Anna, this is just about when you break the law, this is what happens. Is it as simple as that for you?
This is not a simple issue. It's not black and white issue. It's not brown and white, maybe is what I should say, issue. Look, I just came from Central America. I was in Nicaragua this weekend. People are getting killed there. Ortega's thugs, that dictator's thugs, are killing people willy-nilly. There's been over 120 people shot and murdered in Nicaragua in the last 6 weeks. And so folks are fleeing. We have a political asylum law in the books in the United States. People who come here a lot of times undocumented, a lot of times illegally, a lot of times through the border or overstay visas, can apply for that political asylum law, which is in the books. Right. We don't want to be a place that takes political asylees, then change the laws. But right now, it's an available resource for people who are fleeing a volcano that just covered folks in an entire town in ashes and lava in Guatemala, who are fleeing violence in Honduras, who are fleeing a dictator, a corrupt dictator, right, Daniel Ortega, in Nicaragua. So it's a very complex issue. It's about laws. It's about the execution of laws. It's about foreign policy and what's going on in those countries.
Right,
and it's about the fact that desperate people will do desperate things.
Anna, I think you make a great point. By the way, why are they not asking for asylum in Mexico, which almost always is the first point of entry as they're on their way to the United States? Ask for asylum in Mexico. Why is this always our problem? And I think it shows us, by the way, that it's not just about asylum. It's about trying to find a way into the United States by hook or crook, because they don't want to do it the legal way, which is the way you did it, the way my father did it, the way tens of millions of people do it, is legal immigration. We have
a right to control. Well, first of all, there is a legal mechanism.
Who comes into our home?
Steve, there is a legal mechanism for trying to flee and then ask for asylum. You can do it in your home country as well, but you can also do it this way. Again, it gets a little complicated. What is not as complicated is how you choose to enforce the law. The president promised that the policy would be one of love. Do you remember that? Contrast that with what his attorney general, Jeff Sessions, just said about this. Here.
The law requires us to keep children in a different facility than we do for adults. And every time somebody, Hugh, gets prosecuted in America for a crime, American citizens, and they go to jail, they're separated from their children. And we don't want to do this at all. If people don't want to be separated from their children, they should not bring them with them.
Now, that's from Hugh Hewitt, okay? Fully minted conservative. And the reason I point that out, Steve, is this is about having a heart, not a partisan stripe. We choose, as a country, how we enforce the law. You do not have to do it this way, where you get a Democratic senator who won't get let into one of the facilities saying that he saw kids in cages. Don't you think we can do better than that, Steve?
Oh, I do, by the way, and I think our laws should be reformed. This was happening, by the way, under President Obama. This didn't just start happening, separating children from parents. But let's also remember here, when we have a lawless border, which we've tolerated for decades in this country, let's talk about the families who are separated permanently in the United States because their family members are dead, because dangerous illegal immigrants have been tolerated, because sanctuary cities have become a misbegotten policy in places like my hometown of Chicago, in places
they're
like
not
California.
New either.
So
let's bring Anna in because those families,
by the way, those are separated families, Chris, and that's real, and that's permanent.
Well, every separated family is real. And quick fact check, you say when we had a lawless border, like now it is fully enforced, the numbers of people coming across the border, take a look, Steve, because they're going the wrong direction from this administration compared to the last one. Anna, how do you see this in terms of where it needs to go forward?
Well, look, first of all, I think it's very important to know that what happened under President Obama, which I also criticized back then.
And rightly so.
Is different than what is happening now. What happened in 2014 was that we had a surge of unaccompanied minors making it to the border, and they were put in detention facilities, and it was awful. And a lot of people, including myself, including a lot of Latino leaders, criticized it strongly. What is happening now is that families are being separated. Babies are being torn from mother's arms. They are being put in things that look like cages. That's why they don't let the U.S. senators in there, because they don't want people to be able to tell what's going on there. They don't want the pictures to come out, because they know that the American people are people of love, are people that know that this is a country built on immigration, are compassionate people who believe in family unity, and who are going to be shocked and terrorized and horrified by those images.
We're built on legal immigration. We're about to
leave
on immigration.
And yeah, why don't you say that to all
children,
the... Listen,
don't
you know...
try to smuggle...
Hold on.
I can't... There is something I cannot stand as when you interrupt me. I let you speak until you're done.
All right, finish your point, Anna.
Well, you know, why don't you go tell the slaves that were brought here how we're built on legal immigration?
All right, that's not immigration.
We are not built
Slaves
on legal
are not immigration.
Immigration.
The There's point is, we're built on legal immigration. And if you try to smuggle your children across a sovereign border of the United States, then, listen, it's terribly unfortunate. I don't disagree that there are some human tragedies going on, but is that our fault, or is that the fault of the parents who are making that terrible mistake?
But you're discounting the desperation, Steve. You're discounting the desperation.
Look,
why did my family come here two generations ago? They were desperate.
Yeah.
It's not because they were level-headed and had options.
Right.
This was a desperate cause to get here. The system was different then. Now it's harder to get in, and out of desperation, they do it illegally.
No.
Doesn't make it right, but how you deal with it becomes a sensitivity issue. Here's another example of this.
Let me ask you then, what's your answer? Open borders? Is that your answer?
My job is to test power and judge what it does, hold it accountable for what it does. The people will judge it. I hold it accountable. That's what this is about.
Well, you know,
and this winds up being a theme of sensitivity. Hold on. I'll tell you who suffers the most. The victims in every different dynamic. And here's another example of
Hispanics,
it, which is another
primarily.
Topic for you.
Chris,
and look at them in Puerto
Americans
Rico right now. That's what I want to ask you about, Steve. Look at them in Puerto Rico.
Puerto Rico has nothing with immigration. They're Americans.
Hold on a second. No, I'm switching topics. I'm switching topics because
the most.
Hey, Steve.
Okay, but hold on. I want to make one more point. Hispanic Americans suffer the most from illegal immigration in this country, both in terms of dangerous illegal immigrants in sanctuary cities and in terms of illegal worker wage competition. Hispanic Americans, ironically, suffer the most. So by having a good border and sensible immigration, we're actually protecting Hispanic Americans.
Listen, that's a twisted way to look at it, but it takes us to the same point. Anna.
Well, not really.
Well, that's your take. That's what it's all about, exchanging ideas. So in Puerto Rico, the government says dozens were killed. The president, when he goes down there at the time, the estimate was lower. He says, thank God it's not worse. We could have seen something terrible. He was expressing concern. Harvard then does a study. They go through 3,000 different households. They believe the estimate of those who died because of the storm and thereafter, 70 times that number. Not a word from the White House. What's wrong with that, Anna?
What's wrong with that is that it is American citizens that have been treated as second-class citizens. What's wrong with that is that if 4,600 cats and dogs had died in the mainland USA, particularly a red state or a purple state like mine in Florida or in Texas with Hurricane Harvey, it would have been an uproar in this country, and we would have demanded answers. What's wrong with that is that we are now in hurricane season again, and Puerto Rico is still reeling from the shock and the effect of Hurricane Maria. What is wrong with that is that 4,600 Americans have died, and we don't even know but who they are.
Steve,
we don't know their names, and we are not, you know, honoring those deaths by really finding out the truth.
Or at least acknowledging the reality and finding out the number. Steve, final word. Yeah. Go ahead.
What happened in Puerto Rico was just an absolute tragedy, right? Two massive hurricanes in succession, an absolute tragedy. The idea, though, that, and I think this is where you're going with this, Chris, that the president somehow willfully neglected them, or at least that Anna was going, because they're brown people, because they're Hispanics, is the most absurd and insulting notion. When the left doesn't want to talk about policy, they constantly call this president a racist, and
All
it's
right,
getting
Steve.
Old and tired because he's not.
Well, Steve, look, on a final word of it, if he acknowledged it, there'd be a lot less criticism. But I appreciate you being here. You make the show better. Steve, thank you. Anna, appreciate it as always. Steve Cortes, Anna Navarro. All right. Things are spicy tonight, and they stayed that way when we were with Senate Democratic leader Chuck Schumer in a sit-down today. We put him to the test on the state of play in D.C. and whether he can make the case for your votes in the midterms. You'll want to see this next.